So welcome to the third part. We have already discussed the first two parts of UPSC Prelims 2019 General Studies Paper 1. So in this part 3, we are starting from question number 51. This is set D. So 51st question, as you can see, is from medieval India. The question says, with reference to Mughal India, what are the differences between Jagirdar and Zamindar? So Jagirdars as such, you know, they owned a Jagir. So, it is, you know, Jagirdars were holders of land assignments in lieu of judicial and police duties. So, Jagirdars actually were given Jagirs, and as you should know, during Mughal times and even during the Delhi Sultanate rule, the Jagir term was there, and it was, you know, grant given as a Jagir. You know, even Rajput rulers used to grant Jagirs, even for various purposes, not just for judicial, police, but also military services. Even grants for religious and charitable purposes were there as a Jagir being granted. So this is the Jagir, and they were granted rights in respect of land revenue. So they could collect land revenue there, but they had to perform other functions too, like military and others. So our first statement here says Jagirdars were holders of land assignment in lieu of judicial and police duties, whereas Zamindars were holders of revenue rights without obligation to perform any other duty other than revenue collection. So this is not correct, because Zamindars also had such, you know, responsibilities on them. So like Jagirdars, Zamindars also were administrative officers basically, who were supposed to perform other functions. They were not just revenue collectors. Then second statement, and Zamindars, as you must know, the Zamindars still continue to have hold in villages, and during British rule, they continue to support the Britishers too, and post independence, we have tried to eliminate the Zamindari system. So that is there. So Zamindari system has almost been eliminated, but their status and their command in the villages is there. So they were not just revenue collectors. And second statement says, land assignments to Jagirdars were hereditary, and revenue rights of Zamindars were not hereditary. So actually, Jagirdars' land assignments, they were also not hereditary, because Jagirs given to one entity, if they continue to remain hereditary, then they used to get hold on it, and they would become the feudals of the Mughal emperor or the power in the center. So that is why it was tried that Jagirs don't remain hereditary. So Jagirdars were also not hereditary, though Zamindars, it turned out to be hereditary in most cases. Even Zamindari was not supposed to be hereditary. So both the statements as such are incorrect. Land assignments to Jagirdars surely were not hereditary, and Zamindars were not only revenue collectors. So the 51, the answer should be D, neither one nor two. So then 52nd question is, with reference to land reforms in independent India, which one of the following statements is correct? So the first statement is, the ceiling laws were aimed at family holdings and not individual holdings. So again, if you remember, only one of the four statements are correct. So the ceiling laws, you know, why would they be aimed at? You just have to understand by logic. You may not know so much in detail about land reforms. Still, land reforms are not post-independence. You know, the Bhudan movement initiated by Vinoba Bhave had spearheaded this demand for land reforms, that, you know, redistribution of land is required, because those who owned the land owned huge acres of land, and there were landless laborers too. So this redistribution was essential, and it was undertaken in the country. So there was ceiling on amount of land which you can hold, which a person can hold. So the first statement says that ceiling laws were aimed at family holdings and not individual holdings. So why family holdings would have ceilings and why not an individual holding? So of course, it may be other way around, but not, of course, not that ceiling laws will not be for family holdings. So this A statement is absurd. It is incorrect. Then second statement says the major aim of land reforms was providing agricultural land to all the landowners. So, of course, this is correct. Land reforms was for providing agricultural land to the landless. We'll see two other options too. We'll not just jump to B. It, C says it resulted in cultivation of cash crops as a predominant form of cultivation. So, why would land reforms result in cultivation of cash crops? Rather, if a huge amount of land is owned by one entity, he may think of cultivating cash crops. So, it did not result in this, of course. And D says land reforms permitted no exemptions to the ceiling limits. There cannot be anything which will have no exemptions. So this is also an extreme statement. So 52, the correct answer is B. Then the 53rd question is, the Global Competitiveness Report is published by, and there are four multilateral international organizations given. So here you should know that such reports are very much in news, and we have also quite often covered them in current affairs, and every time it is emphasized that report or any index and which entity publishes it is generally asked in UPSC, so you should know about it. So here on this page on the website, you can see the first news itself covers the global competitiveness report. So it is the details you can see. It is produced by World Economic Forum. So it report is based on the global competitiveness index. So here you can see the correct answer for 53 should be C, World Economic Forum, as mentioned here clearly. Then next question is 54. Consider the following statements about the Charter Act of 1813. So this is again history, modern history related question. And the statements given here are these three. It ended the trade monopoly of East India Company in India except for trade in tea and trade with China. So if you have done Charter Act of 1813, you will clearly know that it ended trade monopoly of East India Company, but did not end trade in tea, trade in opium and trade with China. So this exemptions were there. So first statement is correct. And second statement, it says it asserted the sovereignty of the British Crown over Indian territories held by the company. So sovereignty of British Crown over Indian territories, that British Crown is sovereign and it is under them that the company would be acting. Yes, that is true. Third statement says the revenues of India were now controlled by the British Parliament. So East India Company continued to rule the country. This is a very known, well-known fact in modern India till after the revolt of 1857. It was in 1858 when rule transferred from the company to the British government. So crown rule came. So at that time, it would be at that time that revenues would go to India. Till before that, no. So third statement is clearly incorrect. So 54, the correct answer should be 1 into A. So that is the answer. So this is simple history and a little understanding which can easily give you the answer here. Next question 55 is, with reference to Swadeshi movement, consider the following statements. One, it contributed to the revival of indigenous artisan crafts and industries. Of course, Swadeshi movement promoted goods made in India. So, of course, it would contribute to revival of indigenous artisans. And second, it says National Council of Education was established as part of the Swadeshi movement. So, Swadeshi also emphasized on education in national education as such. So, that was important part of Swadeshi movement. So, second statement is also correct. So, here 55, the correct answer is C. Then next is 56. Consider the following pairs, movements and their leaders. So the first one is All India Anti-Untouchability League. Second is All India Kisan Sabha. And third is Self-Respect Movement. So all these are specifically mentioned in modern history textbooks. Even Spectrum has Self-Respect Movement covered in detail. E.V. Ramaswamy Naikar is clearly a name linked there. All India Kisan Sabha, also Swami Sahajanand Saraswati, is linked, and All India Untouchability League, Anti-Untouchability League, also had Mahatma Gandhi as its leader. So here for 56, the correct answer is D. Then 57, the question is, which one of the following is not a Harappan site? So this is a little difficult question, because when you study of Harappan sites to the standard old texts, you have Chandhudaru coming across. Both Digi also has been known as Harappan site, but the other two, it's a little dicey, Sohokara and Desilpur. So I myself was not aware of which one is the correct answer, but actually the correct answer is C. So 57, the correct answer is Sohokara. Desilpur is actually a Harappan site in Gujarat. So, and Sohokara is actually known for its copper plate inscription. So copper as such was, copper plate inscription was found here. It's in Gorakhpur in UP. Then 58th question is, in which of the following relief sculpture inscriptions is Ranyo Ashoka mentioned along with stone portrait of Ashoka? So again, this is a culture related question and little difficult because this has not been recently in news. So this is actually a portrait of Ashoka which has been found at Kanganahalli. So this is also a difficult question if you are not aware of this history. But you should know that this is actually mentioned in this book by Upinder Singh. So if you have access to this book, you will see that this has been covered here, Ranyu Ashoka. So this is the book you can see. I opened this in History of Ancient and Early Medieval India. But again, how many books would you cover and how much would you do? Because again, you can see this is on page number 333 here. So it's a huge text on only on ancient to medieval. So, and it's not a general question, which will be found in every history textbook. So I personally would not suggest that anyone should go ahead and pick up these books and start reading them, because standard history related content you would find, if this is a standard question, it you would find in any history textbook. So if they specifically want to ask a question from a specific text, then they make sure that the question asked is such that it is not covered in other texts. So if that is the case and how it is done, and you have to pick up and find out such minute details in some text, which, you know, because there's one more question which has come from the same text which we will not find anywhere else, and it's clearly picked up from here. So we'll see this Upinder Singh book again later too, or in a little while. So you don't need to go ahead and start reading that book or start covering from there, because yes, there are 2-3 questions from it, but then still you can skip those questions rather than, you know, going ahead, because even it's not straightforward. It's a huge book which has to be read, studied, revised, so it would be time consuming and not worth the efforts. Rather, you can earn more through efforts somewhere else in the same paper, you know, in general studies. Then 59th question is, consider the following: deification of the Buddha, treading the path of bodhisattvas, and image worship and rituals. Question is, which of the above are the features of Mahayana Buddhism? So you should know if Buddhism has been prominently a topic asked by UPSC, and this is a simple question on Buddhism, because everybody knows there are two sects of Buddhism majorly, Mahayana and Hinayana. So Hinayana is older Buddhism, and they do not believe in bodhisattvas, they do not believe in image and idol worship and rituals. So Mahayana Buddhism actually believes in image worship and rituals, and, you know, in bodhisattvas, and they deification means making it a deity, that Buddha is a deity, a god. So that is 1, 2 and 3. All three are correct from Mahayana Buddhism. So 59, it's a simple question. The answer is B. Then again 60, you can see the same book content is there. This is, with reference to forced labor vishti in India during the Gupta period, which one of the following statements is correct? So there are four statements given about vishti, which is forced labor. So everybody would have come across vishti is there in all history textbooks, but so much of detail about vishti is not there in any text. So here you can see this, four statements are given, out of which only one statement is correct. So this was vishti, forced labor during Gupta period. So the first statement says it was considered a source of income for the state, a sort of tax paid by the people. Second, it was totally absent in Madhya Pradesh and Kathiawar regions of the Gupta Empire. Third, it says forced laborers were entitled to weekly wages. Now if it is forced labor, how will they get wages? If it's wages given, then it's not forced, or rather it's not free labor as such. So that is a little dicey, but yes. And fourth, it says the eldest son of the laborer was sent as the forced laborer. So which laborer, if the laborer himself is not forced, the eldest son is forced? So this is again a complicated statement, tried to be making it complicated. So C and D actually are not the answers. Which of the following, so out of A and B, one of the statement is correct. Which of the four are correct is the question. So this again has been picked up from the same book, Upinder Singh. So here you can see, we'll go to this link. So this is another page of the same textbook by Upinder Singh. Here it is on page number 508. So this talks of forced labor vishti, here you can see. So here you can see it says that forced labor became more common than before in this period, that is the Gupta period. The fact that it is mentioned along with taxes in land grants inscriptions suggests that it was considered a source of income for the state, a sort of tax paid by the people. So you can see this is exactly picked up from here. The fact that most of the inscriptions referring to Vishti came from Madhya Pradesh and Kathiawar regions may suggest that this practice was more prevalent in these regions. So that's exactly the statements given here. You can see B, the statement has been reversed. It says it was totally absent. So this is an incorrect statement. C and D are also incorrect. So A is the correct answer here. So of course, this is a difficult question, and you don't need to run after, you know, covering the source for this question to gain this 1 or 2 marks. So you can skip it. Then next is, which one of the following groups of plants was domesticated in the New World and introduced in the Old World? So this is modern history related question. New World, Old World referred to, that is, the Old World is the world which was known before American continent was discovered. So New World is the American continent, and from there many crops were introduced. So these are crops from the American continent. So there are four options given, and question says, which one of the following groups of plants were domesticated in the New World and introduced into the Old World? So they are, you know, naturally from the New World, from American continent, and they were introduced in the rest of the world. So here, out of the four, you can just by elimination understand what is the correct answer, because cotton, if you have done history, ancient history, you should know cotton was known even during the Indus Valley civilization. So cotton is not, cannot be on the option. So B and C is completely eliminated. Then next is wheat. Wheat again has been, rice, wheat have been staple crops and have been sown worldwide during ancient medieval times. It's not something which came during modern times, because American continent was discovered by Christopher Columbus when he went to discover in sea route to India. So that was during modern times. So of course, wheat and cotton surely cannot be part of this group. So in that case, the only option which remains is A, and the correct answer is A, tobacco, cocoa and rubber. Then next is question number 62. It says, consider the following statements. Asiatic lion is naturally found in India only. 2. Double humped camel is naturally found in India only. 3. One horned rhinoceros is naturally found in India only. So out of these, which is found only in India? So Asiatic lion has been prominently in news. We have also covered it quite often. The lions were also suffering from an infection. So that was when it was prominently in news. You can see it has been covered on the website too. So Asiatic lion is found only in India naturally. So that is correct. So you can see this is where we have covered in February 2019. So you can see. In Vet Institute's ambulance noted in 98 crore lion conservation plan. So it's 9 number news. So it's mentioned below. So about Asiatic lion, they are found only in India and only in Gujarat. So that is a fact, has been quite often mentioned with respect to this coverage. And second statement, it's about, you can see question paper, double humped camel is naturally found in India only, and third is one horned rhino is naturally found in India only. So one horned rhino are from Kaziranga National Park in Assam, so that is well known, but then they are found in the Indian subcontinent, because again it was in news. You can see here that there was a conference which was held for conservation of one horned rhino. So that is the coverage here. We'll go to that too. So this talks about, this is March 2019 news. So here it talks about India to tie up with four nations to save rhinos. So this is the coverage here. So this here you can see. So this was Asian rhinos, second Asian rhino range countries meeting. So to save different species of rhinos, so one horned rhinos, they are found in the Indian subcontinent. So in the adjoining countries also, they are found. So it was Nepal, Bhutan also, where one horned rhinos are found. So second statement is actually, third statement is incorrect. So number three is incorrect, means C and D cannot be the option. So double hump the camel also found naturally in India. If you may or you may not know it, but if you know these two things, then you can clearly say that only A statement is correct. So for 62, the correct answer is A. Then 63rd question is, consider the following pairs, famous places and river. So the first one is Pandharpur, Chandrabhag, Tiruchirappalli, Kaveri and Hampi, Malaprabha. Again, here Hampi is famously known, you know, of the Vijayanagar Empire. It was lying between Krishna Tungabhadra River. So Hampi is not on River Malaprabha. So three is incorrect, is surely known. So if you know this much information, you can easily solve this question, that because the only option which is not having three as part of it is A. So one and two are correct. and Pandharpur on Chandrabhaga River, because it's a famous religious site, Pandharpur in Maharashtra. Chandrabhaga, it's also famous. So if you've done a little of culture, you'll be knowing this too. And even without knowing this, if you've done medieval history also a little about Vijayanagara Empire, you would know Hampi is Krishna Tungabhadra River. So the correct answer for 63 is A. Then next question is 64. In a given year in India, official poverty lines are higher in some states than in others. So official poverty lines will be different. So first you should understand the question. What it is trying to say is official poverty lines. So there are official poverty lines, like, you know, there is internationally also $1 a day as official poverty line too. So means anybody earning less than $1 a day is poor. So that kind of, so if it's in India, a standard official poverty line is there. In some states it may be higher. So why it will be higher in some states than others is the question. Means official poverty line, if in some state is say 100 rupees, then in some state it may be 150 rupees or 120 rupees or so. Why it would be higher? So poverty rates vary from state to state. A. It says price levels vary from state to state. So and C says gross state domestic state product varies from state to state, and D, quality of public distribution varies from state to state. So of course poverty line has nothing to do with quality of public distribution, and gross state product, some may be high earning, less earning, that is true. But then price levels, when price levels vary, because what is required in poverty line definition is you should be able to buy basic requirements like food, etc. So what is the cost of that is seen. So if price levels vary from state to state, then there is a need for different or higher poverty line as such in some states. So B is the correct and most logical answer to this question. So this can be answered only through logic. So 64, the correct answer is B. Then next question is 65. In the context of which of the following do some scientists suggest the use of cirrus cloud thinning technique and the injection of sulfate aerosol into stratosphere? So understand, this is about cloud, cirrus cloud thinning technique. So cloud has been thinned. Generally we hear about clouds being injected with aerosols to have more rainfall. So that is to make the clouds, not for thinning the clouds. But this question is about cloud thinning technique. So there are four options given here, you can see. A is creating the artificial rains in some regions. So this is what we were talking about, but this is not about that because this is cloud thinning. So A cannot be the answer. Reducing the frequency and intensity of tropical cyclones. Of course, tropical cyclones is a cause of concern, and when huge clouds are formed, they are the ones which affect. And C is reducing the adverse effects of solar wind on the earth. But then tropical cyclones, they form at a very quick pace. So whether such cloud thinning techniques can be effective so soon, that is a question too. And solar winds, adverse effects of solar winds, again, stratosphere is also related to ozone. So this is maybe to confuse students. And D says reducing global warming. So again, this may, A can easily be eliminated, but B, C and D, there is, the question is dicey. So you have to have specific knowledge about it. It's actually D. So it's, you can see. The correct answer for 65 is D. It's a technique which is used to reduce global warming, because insulation which takes place is because of clouds. So if cloud thinning takes place, then solar insulation does not stay. Solar heat does not stay on earth, within the atmosphere of the earth, and it can reduce global warming. So such cloud thinning techniques are used. So 65, the correct answer is D. It's a difficult question. 66 is, in the context of which one of the following are the terms pyrolysis and plasma gasification mentioned? So there are four options given, and you should clearly know such pyrolysis are basically burning, and this is a waste to energy technique, plasma gasification and pyrolysis. So UPSC aspirants may have come across this. This I can vaguely recollect is also something which has already been asked by UPSC. So 66, the correct answer is D. So here we have covered about waste to energy techniques as such. So that is there. Then next is, which one of the followings are in Agastya Malaya Biosphere Reserve? So again, this is a difficult question. There are specific names of sanctuaries and tiger reserves mentioned. So people who cover up tiger reserves who don't cover up in so much detail. So you should have specific information, otherwise you will not be able to solve this question. So here you can see this is regarding the Agastya-Malay Biosphere Reserve. It has come in news. So this is the detail regarding it too, when it was established. And here you can see it specifically mentioned the sanctuaries in the reserves and the tiger reserves. So this is where the question has been picked up from. So these four names are specifically there in the question. And this A is the correct option. So 67, the correct answer is A. Then next is, consider the following statements. Some species of turtles are herbivorous. Some species of fish are herbivorous. Some species of marine mammals are herbivorous. And some species of snakes are viviparous. So herbivorous, we understand, is plant-eating animals. Viviparous and oviparous are two terms. Ovi means ovary, means egg. So egg-laying, and viviparous means giving birth to live young ones. So snakes generally lay eggs, but some species are viviparous. So these are the four options given. So of course, some fish are herbivorous, that's true. Marine mammals also, some may be herbivorous, that is also true. Some snakes are also viviparous, is true. And first one, some species of turtles are herbivorous. So of course, here you can see the turtles may also be herbivorous. It's not that all turtles are carnivorous. So of course, the correct answer is D here. So by logic, you may come to the conclusion D, but this is in no other way that you can solve it. Then 69th question, 68 is B. 69th question is, consider the following pairs, wildlife found naturally. So this is specifically about bluefin mahaseer, found in Kaveri River, Irrawaddy dolphin, Chambal River, rusty spotted cat, Eastern Ghats. So out of this, rusty spotted cat has been in news, and not recently in news. It has been covered in news as such too. This is question number 69. So it was there in the Hindu in 2016, I suppose. Here you can see it was covered in news in 2016. So we had covered it on an old website. So here you can see it is 2016 November news. So this is a rusty spotted cat in Andhra Pradesh. So you can see in Eastern Ghats. So specifically this was covered. So rusty spotted cat in Eastern Ghats is true. Irrawaddy. Now Irrawaddy River is in Myanmar in the Eastern Asia. So Irrawaddy dolphin coming in Chambal River, which is a tributary of Yamuna, Ganga Yamuna system. So of course Irrawaddy dolphin in Chambal River is incorrect. Naturally found here, no. And so 2 is incorrect, 3 is correct is the information which we surely know. So if 2 is incorrect, so these A and B are eliminated. Even A, B and D are eliminated. So 1 has to be correct. And the correct answer is C. So bluefin mahaseer, you may or may not know. Still you can solve the question if you recollect, because this rusty spotted cat was prominently in use. So the correct answer here is 1 and 3. So 2 is incorrect. So for 69, the answer is C. So that shows that if you have been covering current affairs over the years, it helps. Then 70 is, why is there a great concern about microbeads that are released into environment? So microbeads, microplastic have been prominently in news, has been covered too. You can see we have also covered it up here too. And plastic pollution, these microbeads are specifically a concern in the marine environment. So because they affect the marine species as such too. Here you can see it's May 2018 news regarding microplastics. Because it must be in environment pollution. So here it is. Second news itself, microbeads in soap, gels, flow into water bodies. So of course, when they flow into water bodies, the concern here is regarding the marine species. So you can see. Most, which are more dangerous than secondary, which is the debris of plastic waste. These are dangerous as they are ingested by small creatures which can find their way into the food chain. So they affect small creatures in the marine environment. So here you can see they are considered harmful to marine ecosystems. This is true. They are considered to cause skin cancer in children, like they've been having a bath with it or something. So B is incorrect. They are small enough to be absorbed by crop plants in irrigated fields. So with marine water irrigation does not take place. So C is incorrect. They are often found to be used as food adulterants. So nobody picks up microbeads, that is pollution in marine environment, and using it as adulterants. Of course, they are not added, but through the marine ecosystem, they enter into the food chain too. So the 70th question, the correct answer is A. Then next is, building Kalyan Mandapas was a notable feature in the temple construction in the kingdom of Chalukya, Chandela, Rashtrakoot, Vijayanagar. So again, this is a difficult question. The correct answer for this is D, Vijayanagar. But again, you will have to do a research on it. I did not know the answer. It has not been, not found it covered in so much detail. So culture related questions we have been seeing over the years have been difficult. So you can see this is Kalyan Mandap of Vijayanagar. So this is a difficult question. You can skip such questions too, but don't skip culture altogether. There are some easy questions from culture too, like on Jainism and Buddhism. So they can easily be covered and solved too. Then 72nd question is, in the revenue administration of Delhi Sultanate, the in charge of revenue collection was known as Amil. So that is true. Amir or Amil was the revenue administration officer in Delhi Sultanate. Second is, the Ikta system of Sultans of Delhi was an ancient indigenous institution. So the Ikta system was introduced by Iltutmish, the Delhi Sultanate ruler. So it was introduced at that time. If you read medieval history, this is a well-known fact. So it was introduced, it's true. So it's not an ancient indigenous institution. So two is incorrect. Third is, the office of Mirbakshi came into existence during the reign of Khalji Sultans of Delhi. So with two incorrect, you're left with one only and three only. So you can have only one or three as correct. So if you know one is correct, then of course one is the correct answer. Mirbakshi, the statement as such, Mirbakshi was the post which came during the time of Mughals. So that is where third statement is actually incorrect. So if you're not aware of this fact, then it may become difficult. Ikta system option being incorrect is very simple. This can be easily guessed. So another medieval India question. Then 73rd question again on medieval India says, consider the following statements. Saint Nimbarka was a contemporary of Akbar. And second is, Saint Kabir was greatly influenced by Sheikh Ahmad Sehundi. So again, this is a difficult question actually. So here you can see. So you have to know about Nimbarka. So here the detail about Nimbarka philosopher is given. He was not actually a contemporary of Akbar. And Saint Kabir being greatly influenced by Sheikh Ahmad Sehundi. Again, popular bhakti movement saints details are given. So this is also an incorrect statement. They are not contemporaries. So that is why D is the correct answer. But this is a difficult question. Then 74th question is, with reference to the British colonial rule in India, consider the following statements. First, Mahatma Gandhi was instrumental in abolition of the system of indentured labor. So this is regarding, the Mahatma Gandhi's struggle. So here in Mahatma Gandhi had also played a role for the rights of ex-indentured laborers in South Africa. So you know about that. And second statement is, in Lord Kempford's war conference, Mahatma Gandhi did not support the resolution on recruiting Indians for World War. So actually Mahatma Gandhi was in favor of supporting Britishers during the World War. He segregated that from, a war as such, which is fought on international issues, on against, such imperial, the imperial powers were fighting, but against values, like when it was a war against Hitler. So he said it was a war on the ideals. So Britishers have to be supported. We can't have such, such regimes like of Hitler's continuing. So he actually supported, and even during his stay in South Africa, he supported the Britishers and wanted the laborers also, his supporters in South Africa, Indians there, to support the Britishers and show them their loyalty so that they in turn would also be favoring the ex-indentured laborers for the service they provide. So Mahatma Gandhi supported resolution on recruiting Indians for World War. So second statement is incorrect. And third statement, it says, consequent upon the breaking of salt law by Indian people, the Indian National Congress was declared illegal by the colonial rulers. So that is also not true. Salt, Indian National Congress leaders were picked up, but it was not then that Indian National Congress was declared illegal because of salt law being broken. So here again, the correct statement, you should know for sure that two is incorrect. So even if you know that two is incorrect, you are left with B, 1 and 3 as the correct answer. So 1 and 3 is correct. So 74, the correct answer is B. And the last question, 75, it says, with reference to Indian National Movement, consider the following pairs. Sir Tej Bahadur Sapru, President, All India Liberal Federation. K.C. Nyogi, member of the Constituent Assembly, P.C. Joshi, General Secretary, Communist Party of India. So P.C. Joshi's name is linked to Communist Party of India, that is true. K.C. Nyogi also, the Constituent Assembly, had limited number of members, and basically the drafting committee, he was also a member of drafting committee, 7-member committee, which was chaired by Dr. Babasaheb Ambedkar. So K.C. Nyogi is a prominent name. Drafting committee was part of the Constituent Assembly. So 2 and 3 are surely correct. So when 2 and 3 are correct, the options which are left with you are, you know, 1, 2 and 3. Because all any other of them do not have both 2 and 3. So even without knowing whether one is correct or incorrect, the correct answer here is D. So these are the 75 questions which we have covered in this video. Remaining questions will be covered in the last part of the question paper discussion. Thank you.